So we're using this Ford trainer board to talk about some of our outputs and what these things look like. This is an older model of car, and so the outputs on here are much more primitive and not as inclusive as what we might see on a car today. But it's a good place for us to start. Some of the major outputs that we've got, one of them is a solenoid. And so the type of output is a solenoid, and we use that solenoid for a variety of things. Solenoids get utilized basically as valves for anything from air to liquid or gas. And so we use solenoids very commonly on fuel injectors as a way to control how much fuel gets injected into the engine. And so these solenoids are just 12 volt devices. When 12 volt is applied, it opens. When I take 12 volts away, it closes, right? And so the module is able to turn this device on and off at such a rate in milliseconds that we can achieve 20%, 30% flow rates by doing so, right? So solenoid is one really common type of output. Another type is just a basic voltage output. And so we use this in a variety of ways. Maybe a module is just going to turn a light on, right? And so on most vehicles, a check engine light is being controlled by a module. That module has the ability to say, hey, we have a fault, we need to turn that light on. And so it might do that by applying a voltage that goes to a bulb or to an LED. Another type of output that we've got is data and network communication. And so this, in our previous example, is probably much more common, that if I've got a check engine light and I want to illuminate that, the dashboard or the instrument panel, that cluster is its own module, and it has the ability to directly turn on the LED that is the check engine light, and the PCM is going to send a data communication to that module in order to make that happen. Data communication and network communication is one way that we achieve a lot of really cool things, where one module can take an input and it can share that data with the whole network. And so that really grows the abilities of the car, especially when we talk about autonomous features and things that we're seeing today with self-driving cars and semi-autonomous cars, but also things that we've become really accustomed to in the last 10, 30 years, like convenience features, being able to use a key fob to unlock the car or hold the panic button and get the horn to go. You know, all those systems are made up of various modules all communicating. The last type of output that we don't have really well represented on this board is a motor. And so a couple different ways that we could look at that. One of those is through something like a fuel pump or a cooling fan, which this board does have, but those are more likely to be actuated by the module controlling a relay. And so that relay is really serving as the output, and the module is grounding typically the control side of that relay to make that happen. And so relays do a great job in that space because they can allow us to control a high current with a very low current, which a module can handle internally. Another type of motor output is something like an electronic throttle body or an idle air control motor. And sometimes we see them also utilized on EGR valves. And so that's where we've got what's often a stepper motor, that the PCM can control that stepper motor through a range of steps, which ultimately represent different elements of twist or movement within the motor. Most motors offer anywhere from 0 to 100 steps or maybe 255 steps. And so the motor can command a very specific point in that motor's travel readily. And so that works well for electronic throttle bodies where we take an input at the accelerator pedal. The driver says, I want 80% throttle. And so that system can then move the throttle plate to that exact location where we need it for operation. So we're going to use our PicoScope here to go through a basic setup of looking at a fuel injector to see what that waveform looks like, and it'll give us some insight into what the PCM is doing in order to control that device. And so I've got my PicoScope here. This is our newest model PicoScope, which is the 4425A. It's got these different connectors, which are pretty cool. You plug them in, and the screen, the software, will automatically recognize that this is a standard X1 set of leads, and it will put that in place for me on whatever channel I plug into. So if I had an amp clamp and I plug it in, it's gonna automatically recognize on the screen that I've got an amp clamp in whatever channel I plugged into. So we're gonna get this set up with our standard lead. I'm gonna use just this back probe here, and then I'm going to ground the other connection just at the chassis ground. And it's important to point out that this newer scope box that I'm utilizing has built-in protection for high voltage spikes. We're gonna see in a minute what this looks like and how there's a large voltage spike created by the solenoid. That high voltage could hurt our scope. And so if we're using one of the older ones, PicoScope boxes, we're gonna have to use a tool called an attenuator. That's a filter that's gonna reduce those spikes and protect the circuitry of the scope. So on this one, I'm just gonna go ahead and plug it in. I'll get back probed here, find my chassis ground, and we'll go to the screen and see what that looks like. All right, so this is what we've got initially on our screen. You'll notice that this software looks different. PicoScope 7 is still in a beta form as of the time of recording this, and so we don't have it on all the computers. I'm using my MacBook, and this is the only one that they've got for Mac, so we'll utilize this for the time being. So I'm gonna start by turning off my B channel, since we don't need that one. I'm gonna go back to my A. We can keep our 100 volt. We'll offset this a little bit so that we can get a little bit more scale. That's just gonna allow us to see it more clearly. We'll come back here and we'll also look at just a little bit less time on our time base. So again, that we can see some more. And last, we're gonna take a trigger and we're gonna put a trigger and I'm gonna pull that up. I want that just right here so I can catch that voltage spike that occurs. And we're gonna put it to the right side so that we can also look at what kind of changes happen as we introduce throttle into our trainer board. So here we've got our waveform set up and we'll talk through what we're looking at. So starting on the left side, you see that we've got system voltage of about 13 volts. We run that across and then here this event, the sharp drop to zero is where my solenoid, and in this case our fuel injector, is being turned on. So a solenoid internally is built as basically an electromagnet. And so I've got a coil winding inside that when energized and when current is allowed to flow through it, it creates a magnetic field. And so with our fuel injector, we're using that magnetic field to pull a pintle and essentially a valve and pull that valve open. So there's a spring that helps keep it in its resting closed position. When I energize this electromagnet, it's pulled open and then fuel can flow past it. And so that's the basic premise of how this is gonna operate. And as we go through that, I keep it open as long as I need to based on my calculation of how much air has entered the engine, right? So this time is my pulse width for my injector. We determine that based on how much air has come in. So think of your mass airflow or your MAP sensor. Those are helping with that calculation. Then when I turn this off, because it's a coil winding, there's going to be a magnetic field that's created when that coil collapses, right? So the magnetic field of the coil will collapse when it's turned off, and that's going to induce a spike in voltage. And so that's what we see right here, and we're getting all the way up to about 68 volts whenever that occurs. We understand that that's an expectation of this system. It is healthy to see that that's going to occur. The next thing that we can look at on this board is that I've got an engine RPM output right here, and I have the ability to change my throttle and see different engine speeds. And so we're gonna do that, and we're gonna watch what happens on my scope. So we're looking at our pulse width. I do a snap throttle and we see that pulse width grows tremendously. It doubles or more depending on how quick I snap the throttle. And so that change is representing how much more fuel we're trying to add to the engine to go with that extra induction of air because the throttle plate got opened. So now we're gonna add a amp clamp to this and so we can talk through some more of the dynamic things that happen with a solenoid as it goes through operation. I'm gonna set this up by taking this and just putting it around one of my wires that go to the same fuel injector that I've got my probe on, and we'll hook this up on the B channel. And so now here on the screen, you can see it's upside down currently, so I'm gonna click on my B channel, just click invert, that's gonna flip it over for me, and then I'm gonna use just the screen here, pull it down, and pull this one up. We're gonna lose that spike a little bit, but that's okay. So now we're gonna talk about what is this. So the two measurements here that we're putting together would be helpful in me understanding that solenoid's ability and really to try to understand whether or not it has movement internally. Because this is a electronic device that also carries out an action, you could imagine as we go to test them, it's important that we've got the ability to make sure that they are okay electrically, but also that they perform the mechanical action that's necessary for the operation of the car or the fuel injector in this case. And so what we're looking at here, my red trace represents the current that's going to that injector. And so we expect it to ramp up like this. There's a concept called coil saturation that occurs where it takes some time to build a magnetic field. It's not built instantly. All of those coil windings have to become a load and see current, and they build that field progressively. And so that's where we see the ramp effect. The other thing that's unique with a fuel injector is this small little dip right here. That small dip represents the actual pintle opening within the fuel injector. And so it's common for us to see that little bump, and that represents that ultimately there was some movement within it. And so it just has to do with the magnetism and the movement within that fuel injector. And so that gives me some confidence that there's internal movement and that this injector should be working well. That's a quick overview of a solenoid's operation and the general concept of outputs and actuators for modules. There's a lot of different types, but really we just use a handful of these in a variety of ways. So solenoid controlling fuel is just one of the operations of a solenoid. We could also use a solenoid to control airflow, to do idle air control, although most of that has gone away as we've began to utilize electronic throttle bodies so readily. And so the really important thing here is just to understand that a module needs to carry out an output or an action, and its ability to do so is going to be somewhat specific in the type of output it is, but ultimately it relies on a lot of the same basic concepts that we've talked about with input sensors. There are going to be connections between that output and the module that are just wires. And so being able to audit the integrity of a wire harness from point to point is just as vital with outputs as it is with inputs. The other thing is that data communication and network communication we talked about. Being able to assess that, the fundamentals of it are still similar and built around wire integrity and abilities for modules to create a safe space for that data to travel. And so there's a lot of specifics that exist there. Those are things that will come with time. This week for the lab, what we're going to focus on is just getting the scope to look at how some of these outputs appear with that equipment, and also looking at how do we audit their behavior and what are some of the pinpoint tests that a manufacturer might share.